Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the City Council work session on Tuesday, April 16th for the water and sewer budget. As you may recall, a couple weeks ago, we voted to begin designing a $61 million wastewater plant, which is going to, it's not the water portion, but it's the sewer portion, which is going to be certainly driving some of our discussion tonight. So we've already kind of committed to paying for some large ticket items, and we'll be discussing how to pay for those items and other enterprise funds tonight. So, City Manager?
Thank you, Your Honor. I think tonight, this presentation, as we go through, you'll see that there's a very positive message that's going to be developed. Through the planning that we've had going on for the last couple years, the water and sewer funds are in a position of strength to be able to address the long-term needs of the city while maintaining a stable and predictable water and sewer rate structure. Like the city's tax rate policy, the water and sewer rate structure will allow for predictable and stable water rates into the future. And as the mayor said, we have a large capital impact coming in the future years, and you'll see that as we go through our rate models. Similar to the general fund, the water and sewer funds have felt the impact of state cuts. The loss of state aid grants for our sewer program equates to a loss of $850,000 this year. If the aid had been in place, we would have had a substantially less increase in our rate, and also could have probably put more money aside for our net assets to help ease us into the to the future years as we start paying off our debt service on the new wastewater treatment plant. And again, we'll be talking a little bit about what we will refer to as net assets. And net assets, I know Judy would get upset with me if I kind of equate it to fund balance, but I'm going to for just simple, illustration. What we're going to try to do, what you're going to see in the presentation is we're going to try to take and we're going to try to have the council develop a policy where we try to keep net assets between 20% and 30% of expenditures. And we have David Heider here from Municipal Finance Services Group, who you saw when he gave the rate study back on March 13th. And it'll be interesting to see when we go through and talk about the rate stabilization. This is a key year for sewer. Water, you'll see our rates are going to stay stable, will be even for this year, but the sewer rates will have an increase, and that increase will be put towards the stabilization fund and the or what we'll refer to as net assets to bring us into that 20% to 30% range. So what I'd like to do is turn it over to David Heider, who will walk us through again quickly the information he provided us earlier on the rate study, and then the and then Judy will talk about the numbers for the fiscal 14 budget. So David?
Okay. Thank you. Good evening, Mayor, Council members. Good to see everybody again. Again, what we're going to do is just go over the rate model. I'm going to talk a little bit about the background, a lot of which we discussed last time. Then Judy's going to talk about the water and sewer budgets in more detail than we went over last time. Just want to emphasize that the study's been conducted in a public manner. There was a the first meeting for the rate study was conducted on December 4th of last year. We had a Rates 101 presentation at the public library. A lot of good discussion with the public there. Went over what goes into a rate study, some of the key issues facing the city, and some of the potential policy issues facing the water and sewer utilities. Next, we had a council workshop similar to this one dealing with policy issues on February 11th. And then last March, we had the results of the study where we had a public input session, and I went through in more detail the rate study. So as a reminder, the goal for the utility rate study is that we want to provide long-term financial health, stability, and predictability within the city's water and sewer enterprise funds. And while we do that, we want to appropriately price water and sewer service based on the costs incurred by the city. So that's really our mission statement, our key goal for the study. And in order to do that, we've developed a tool, a rate model, which really assists us in looking at the long-term planning for the water and sewer funds. A whole host of information goes into that model, operational costs, capital costs, statistics in terms of consumption patterns of your customers, things of that sort. And what that model allows us to do is allows us to have prudent financial planning for the utilities, which results in predictable rate increases, so we know what's coming at us down the road. It allows us to fund significant capital projects, as was mentioned earlier, the significant capital project on the sewer side. And it allows you to proactively manage the system, which results in the lowest rates over time. So if you know what's coming at you, you can plan for that. The rate model looks out over a 10-year period. Again, we forecast it over that period. We use the 2014 budget as our starting point. And some of the categories here, the personnel costs, which would include salaries, insurance, benefits, things of that sort, are inflated in the model on a line item by line item basis based on historical increases and any known changes going forward. Other operating expenses were also forecasted. That includes chemicals, energy repairs, contracts, things like that. The typical key driver there that we're seeing in increases is the utilities for chemicals and energy. And then two other categories of expenditures that are forecasted going forward is one is capital outlays. So that would be cash funded capital projects. And that's based upon your approved capital improvement plan. And the key driver there is, in terms of the cost, is really the magnitude of the capital improvement plan. What do you have coming at you? On the water side, you've made a number of significant investments, so it's pretty steady state going forward. On the sewer side, as you know, you have very significant expenditures. On the other category is debt service, which would include principal and interest on both current and any future loans. And that's driven, again, by the capital improvement plan and the magnitude of those projects. So we forecast your revenue requirements, so the cost of providing the service over a 10-year period. We talked last time about several approaches that you can use to adjusting revenues or rates to fund those revenue requirements. And one approach would be to take a break-even approach where you wait and then you jack rates up based upon those expenditures. That often results in significant rate shock. And significant, obviously, impact in customers' bills. What we're recommending is taking more of a stabilized financial plan approach, where we, knowing what's coming at us in the future, we adjust rates in a smooth and predictable manner. And lastly, to allow us to do that, we do need to have some net assets that allow us to have those smoother increases. And so what we're recommending is that you adopt a rate stabilization reserve policy, which on an annual basis, you would increase assets or utilize those net assets to stabilize user rates from year to year. And the industry standard is what we're recommending, that you maintain a minimum unrestricted net assets of between 20 to 30% of the fiscal year's cash requirements. If you don't have a rate stabilization or those unrestricted net assets, it's very difficult to have those smooth increases because you're requiring increases in rates depending upon those, how your expenditures are going to change year by year. So now I'm going to turn it over to Judy to talk about the budget.
Can you hear me? Good evening. We're going to talk about the enterprise funds, the water and sewer. The city of Portsmouth has two enterprise funds. Now, the enterprise funds accounts for the operations that are financed and operated in a very similar manner as the private sector. And in order to have an enterprise fund, you must have fees and charges that are significant enough to cover the cost of providing goods and services. And this would include capital costs and depreciation and debt service. Now, again, we have two enterprise funds, water and sewer. But it's important to note here that our property taxes from our general fund do not subsidize the water and sewer funds. And one of the reasons for that is that we do have customers outside of the city limits. Now, before we get into the actual line items of the water and sewer, I want to talk about the water and sewer position summary schedule. Now, this summary schedule is on page 294 of your budget document. However, it is slightly changed from the budget document, so we're going to utilize this slide here. And it actually equates to an increase of 1.2 positions that we're proposing for FY14. And the reason for that is we're requesting to add an environmental compliance coordinator, and this is as a result of new permitting requirements. This was also filled by an employee, the engineering technician, so it eliminates the engineering technician position there. I'd also like to add a water sewer meter foreman, also also filled in-house, which would eliminate the one CAD tech. And this is where it's different in your budget document. We originally kept a two CAD techs, and now we're reducing it. We're not going to fill the one CAD tech. So basically, the increases would be the in addition to the billing clerk. We've talked about this in the past, that I in the finance department, I have two billing clerks preparing 8,000 water and sewer bills. So we do feel the need of adding the clerk. And then 0.2 FTEs for the project administrating the contracts and invoices associated with the wastewater treatment plant. So now the proposed water budget, this is where we get into that full accrual basis of accounting as opposed to cash requirements. Now, because the budget document is prepared using the GFOA, or Government Finance Officers Association guidelines, the water sewer budgets are prepared in accordance with GAAP in your budget document. This is a generally accepted accounting principles. So enterprise funds use an economic measurement focus, which means that revenues are recorded when earned and expenses are recorded when the liability is incurred. And this is very different than the general fund. So when the city manager was talking about this kind of a similar situation with fund balance on the general fund, this is true, except the balance sheet actually in an enterprise fund has long-term liabilities and long-term assets. So the difference between the assets and the long-term assets is your net assets. So the enterprise funds, both water and sewer, use the full accrual basis of accounting. And how this differs is that, for instance, depreciation, if you see the depreciation, $1.5 million there, is you're writing off your assets on an annual basis. But we do not need to raise cash for depreciation. It's an expense on a full accrual basis. So what we have to do in order to establish what the user rate is going to be is to convert from a full accrual basis of accounting to a cash requirements. So we take out depreciation, but we add in accrued interest, and we add in principal debt. Now the principal debt of $1.5 million, again, is on the balance sheet, so there's not a line item for that. So this is the conversion over to cash requirements. So here, for water, for FY14, we need to raise $9.5 million. In cash. Now this pie chart here represents the total $9.5 million. Now, unlike the general fund, the water and sewer divisions are more capital heavy. So as you can see, the personnel costs are 21% and other operating 28%, close to 29%. But if you look at the left-hand side of the chart between debt service and capital outlay, it's about 50% of your total cash requirements for capital-related expenses. This is just another pie chart, actually. As you can see, the on the right-hand side, the capital and the equipment being about 50% of total cash requirements, and then your other operating is broken down into a little bit more detail. Your administrative overhead, your stock materials, professional services, repair and maintenance, and utilities, and chemicals. Again, this is a table that's representing it in dollar form. Down at the bottom, you have your capital projects and your equipment, rolling stock, again, making up 50%, where your personnel costs of 21%. Now, the key operational budget changes for the water department. This is our first year of operations for the water treatment plant, so we're getting the numbers better. And after the first year of operations, we do have an increase in the sludge and grit removal and the chemicals due to the treatment plant. And then again, under personnel, we have the health insurance and the retirement, which has affected all of the departments within the city. The water capital outlay, this is identified in the capital improvement plan, proposing $2,140,000 in capital outlay. And this is your pay-as-you-go. So this is actually cash to be expended in FY14. Now this table here represents this graph has actually been you've seen this graph before in the public input session, and it represents the cash requirement for each fiscal year. Each bar represents the total of cash requirement. So if we focus on FY14 here, the blue represents personnel costs, the red represents other operating, and the green represents your capital outlay, so that's your cash for capital outlay, and purple is your debt service. Now, one of the things, as Dave Hyder talked about earlier in the presentation, about utilizing the stabilization approach. Now, if we look at the orange line, this is your stabilization approach. So you want to smooth out and be stable and predictable for rate increases in your future years. Now, if we use the break-even approach, we would be raising the water rates in FY14. So, I need the right button here. So this gap right here, the top bar, we need $9.5 million, but we are proposing not to have any increase in the water. Yes.
I had a quick question. You can see the unrestricted net assets is trending down.
Mm-hmm.
And so in FY19, it might be below the recommended 20 to 30%. So my question is this something that your department would take a look at in FY15 and 16 and 17? And so each year you could, if you needed to kind of make mid-course corrections, you would be tweaking it as you go forward?
Yes.
You're not locked into these rates for
we're
the next
not
5 years.
In,
so percentages right. that we want to be within. We want to be within 20 to 30% of the operating cost.
So you can always be looking forward a few years and tweaking mm-hmm. it as you yep. go along.
Right, right. Okay. This is a tool. This is a guideline. So we're following the trends and okay. you know, utilizing the net assets. Yep. So if we had the... So with the stabilization approach, we're proposing no increase in FY14 and then a slight increase in FY15 and try to maintain like a 3% increase with this tool, with this model right here. So now revenues for the water fund, the $8 million is the user fee and the minimum charges that we need to raise in order to have the cash requirements. Now, again, that's the bigger piece of the pie. There's not a lot of revenue collected outside of the user fee for the water fund. But what from the previous chart, utilizing the net assets, you can see the $900,000 use of unrestricted net assets, and that's what we're proposing to use this year to keep that rate at zero. So again, the FY14 proposed water rate, no increase. We do use a two-tier inclining rate structure, as we have in the last several years. The first tier would be users of the first 10 units of water, and as we, one unit of water is 748 gallons. And within each tier, the first tier, we have $4.15. We also break out the capital portion of that rate. So you can see that capital-related expenses is $3.11, and then the other operating would be $1.04. So your first tier it would be $4.15 for the first 10 units of water. And then the second tier, still the capital-related expenses is $3.11. Other operating is $1.89, so it's $5 for the second. Anything over 10 units of water used.
Judy, just yes. I think it's important for the council to understand that the reason that we're trying to remain the keep the water rate flat is there's two reasons. One is that we believe that we have sufficient amount of unrestricted net assets to smooth out the rate, because we're looking, we weren't just looking at the water side. It'll become more apparent when you look at the sewer side of the enterprise fund, where because the utility bill is the utility bill for people, you know, even though from an accounting standpoint we have to maintain separate enterprise funds, we have separate users, two different utilities, but for all intents and purposes we wanted to make sure as we developed this policy that the rate would not jump significantly for both. So
Tony, do you have a question?
I know when you look at this, you think, brilliant accounting mind, but I am, I don't know, am I the only one that is not, like, really strong on all this language that's going back and forth? All right.
Okay, so let me try to go back to the other, to the slide.
Can I ask a question? I think
sure.
help me, maybe others as well. Sure. The full accrual method,
mm-hmm.
I understand the concept because you can't wait for the cash to come in, right? You know the transaction is going to occur in the future. And so
well, the full accrual is just it's not on a cash basis,
right?
Like the general fund is cash basis, a modified accrual basis of accounting for general fund. It's a different setup. GASB had allowed some changes for governmental accounting because it's very different. It's a year to year budget. Where in the private sector, you have your net assets and you have your depreciation and you're writing off.
Could you go back to the slide where you showed that? Okay.
Okay. So there are certain items in a private sector that would be accounted for or expensed, unlike the general fund. So that would be your depreciation. There is no depreciation on the balance sheet or in line items for the general fund. So, but we do have to account for depreciation in the assets in the enterprise fund. That's an expense. So every year we have to expense that, but it's not cash going out the door.
It's not a cash item.
It's not a cash item. So so when we convert to cash, we say, well, we don't need to raise that $1.5 million, but you would expense it.
So the best way to think about the enterprise funds is utilizing the cash requirement. The full accrual is really what we need to do to comply with our governmental accounting standard board's requirement. Our auditor will convert it. I don't believe that you need to fixate on full accrual at all.
Right.
Just put it aside because the cash requirements are very similar to what we do on the general fund side, except in a couple of small areas. So I would suggest you think of it more on the cash requirements because you have your debt in there like we do on the general fund side. You have your interest in there like you do on your general fund mm-hmm. side. So any interest on debt you have in there just like your general fund side. So I would just look at the cash requirements side.
I don't know if that helps at all, but we often explain, we set rates. You have to set rates based on cash needs. So it's like a checking account. So if you balance your checkbook, that's essentially you have to have enough revenue coming in to pay for those expenses. So we have to set rates on a cash requirements basis. As John mentioned, you're essentially required by law to report on an accrual basis. So it's just a transfer of how to report, but it doesn't impact the rates in any way, shape, or form.
And we use this slide because in the budget document, it's on a full accrual basis. So
I understand, but the with the accrual basis, you're basically taking. You're saying that you have the amount of cash on hand, even though the transaction may not have been completed, right?
That's
correct. Like, for example, if I sell a TV and you pay for it by credit card. I would say at that moment on the accrual basis, I received that money even though the credit card company may not have delivered the cash to me yet.
Actually, maybe to try to explain it this way on accrual basis, we have to record revenue. So when we send out water bills, water sewer bills, that's a revenue right then and there. We don't have the cash. We may not get the cash for a year or 2 years, but we record it in that period as
it's
a revenue.
Receivable.
Unlike the general fund, there's some exceptions in the general fund. That's why it's called modified accrual basis. But technically, if we send out a bill for police outside detail or something, we don't even record that revenue
until
they get the cash.
But for the example you just started with, that was great. You send out the bill, you immediately count it as income received.
Right.
So is that why you need that? I think the number was 30% cash on hand.
No.
I got one nodding no, one nodding yes.
Well, I mean, the reason you need that cash on hand is in order to allow for smooth and predictable rate increases. It's not a portion of that which we would typically call a working capital reserve, which would be, which could potentially be fluctuations in budgets and true cash flow in and out of the door.
I'm really sorry if this if this is simple for everybody else.
We're going to ask you how to build a bridge next.
But no, that would be easier. The so underneath that model, if you send out the bill for the water bill, and then you declare, hey, this is accounts receivable.
Right.
You don't have the cash in hand, but you declare it's accounts receivable, and then you get an electric bill you have to pay. But you don't have that cash in hand. So is that why you need that 30%?
It's really bigger picture than that, in that you have in 2016, you have, I think it's about $6 million worth of new debt due to the water treatment plant. Wastewater treatment plant.
I think Tony's talking about the minimal.
The absolute minimum.
Yeah, the absolute minimum that you should be carrying, not the additional beyond that.
Yeah, if you're talking the 20 to 30%, though, that essentially is that capital rate stabilization reserve, which allows you to not have to jack rates up.
Again, think of it like the fund balance. I mean, because it really is. When you're looking at it from a cash basis, the unrestricted net assets really could be looked at as a fund balance. So with our fund balance ordinance, we have utilized, we have taken some of our committed fund balance and used it for, let's say, debt service stabilization, because on some instances we do not receive state grants in on a timely fashion, and so, or they may be delayed a year, but we supplement that on the revenue side with debt service reserve. And so you could look at it that way, and it helps stable. And if you looked at the chart, if you remember the chart that I had in the presentation, I showed a chart that showed how much unassigned and committed fund balance that we used over the last 5 years, and that helped offset the tax rate to keep it predictable and stable. Same with our stabilization funds. So I think the way to think about the unrestricted net assets is almost like a stabilization fund, if you will. I know I'm butchering the accounting portion of it, but I just wanted to.
What is the difference between unrestricted net assets and fund balance? What are the unrestricted net assets? I don't understand what they're.
It's an accounting term. You know, you have a balance sheet, and you have assets minus liabilities will equal your net assets.
And the net assets, so if you look at the graph that says water.
It could be cash. Part of it, yes, of course.
Now, see the water fund here that's got the ratio of unrestricted net assets. So the net assets include some cash.
Yes.
And it, assets, unencumbered it's cash. Assets.
Correct.
What?
It's the available cash.
Available cash.
That's all it is. Okay, and then on the revenue portion, $909,000 is under use of unrestricted net assets.
Very similar to the general fund when we use reserve for debt service. This is the terminology is just a little different.
And where did that cash come from?
It's arrived from surpluses from year to year.
All right. Okay. And what we're leading up to here is to change the method. Replenishing that fund or increasing it.
There were times in the past that we ran deficits in water and sewer several years ago. We've been slowly building.
We haven't run a deficit for a while.
And so there have been surpluses in the last few years, and very similar to the general fund, if you think about it that way. The unassigned fund balance.
So
we maintain a certain level, so if we exceed that level,
one of the challenges is trying to predict cash flow, because we're a consumption-based system. So depending upon the weather, if it's a dry summer, we'll have a lot of people using water. If it's a wet summer, sometimes we won't get as much water, so our revenue stream can fluctuate depending upon the seasons and stuff like that.
Chris?
So is that the simple reason why you maintain a higher balance of a higher ratio, or are there other reasons why you maintain a higher ratio of unrestricted net assets to operating budget?
That's the industry standard.
Yeah, it's because of fluctuations, continual declines in usage and things of that sort, and also the potential liability if you have a line blow up and the to have those funds available for emergencies.
Brad, you added a...
So the proposed 14 water budget, the cash requirements are $9.5 million. So the goal here is to have the unrestricted net assets be between maybe $2 million and...
$3 million,
right? Correct. In there. And are they there now? What is the current balance?
29%.
It's on the chart.
All right, so it's under 14. So we're okay now. Right.
Correct. And that's the reason for no increase in 14.
And the reason is, Counselor, is that, as I said, we're trying, you know, we're taking the water side and keeping it flat this year, because when we get into the sewer budget, you'll see that we're actually increasing to get more net unrestricted net assets in, so that in future years we can smooth it out. So that's why we're using it this year.
Jack.
Just a really quick, very much smaller question, but on the chart that shows the equalization, would you not have the endpoints match up, or are you going to have a step in after fiscal year 18 where it jumps from the orange line up to the green line?
This one is theoretical, but you'd see that there actually is some benefit in doing when we run the scenarios and we do increases in a more stabilized approach, there is the compounding that happens. So if you do a 12% increase in sewer in 14 and you do subsequent increases after that, you're getting the benefit of having that increase in the initial year. So actually, in our recommended approach on the sewer side, it's about a 10% difference in 2014 between using the break-even approach and the stabilized approach. So okay, if you use a break-even approach, you'll end up 10% higher than you would have at the stabilized.
But you wanted to do a stabilization because of the big step between 15 and 16, and you wanted to smooth that out.
Correct.
So it's, but at some point in the long run, you need to be the same.
Well, the point, what we're going to try to do is we're going to get as close to the same as possible, where because of two separate funds, you have... You know, are you talking about both water and sewer? You're just talking about the
well, I'm just looking at the chart. I don't know which it's talking about.
I think maybe I can clarify. You're right that the ultimate goal is that in our plan, in the outer years, we're in basically inflationary increases, which would be the same under a break-even or a standardized financial plan. It's just, how do we handle this big hump that's coming at us on the sewer side?
And yeah, that's why I was saying I would have expected those lines to join sometime in the future. And I was just wondering, I guess it's after fiscal year 18, but it still looks like there's a step in there somewhere.
Yeah. Right. But the green line is always going to be...
Let's wait till we get... We're going to have a discussion on the sewer side.
That's okay. I mean, it's a small question. Yeah. I just know.
Yeah. It's a good question.
It's a good question.
Nancy, do you have a water question or
yeah,
a fool
well,
accrual question?
I have a question. Basically, what we're doing is setting up a stabilization fund to avoid huge peaks and valleys.
Right. And as David said, in when we get into the sewer review of the budget, you'll see that if we don't do anything, we could keep the rate as it is in the sewer budget this year. But if you do that, you have a compounding effect that
Correct.
You mentioned, and you have it kind of a perfect storm hitting you in 18, where you have not only the compounding effect hitting you, but you also have your debt service coming in that's going to be a large payment. So the idea is to try to smooth that out. This is the year you need to do it.
It's like the health stabilization.
Mm-hmm.
If we have a big we don't suffer from that because
right.
we have the money in reserve.
Correct.
Okay, so it's
That's
the same principle.
Same principle, correct.
That's all I'm going to go with.
So back to,
yes, Tony.
Back to the unrestricted net assets ratio. The table seems to imply a negative decline, you know, back in 2000 or in the future, mm-hmm. 2015, you'd have 35%, then it drops 26, 23, 21. And you want to be in that bound of 20 and 30. Is there concern about 19, or you're just going to we'll have this conversation again? And
yeah, we've evaluated, and if you continue with 3% increases post 2018, you would move back up in that range.
Okay.
So, but it is something that you'd use it as a tool and evaluate on an annual basis.
And the reason that we're bringing that down is also to try to, as I said earlier, to keep it with sewer. You know, the whole idea is that it's two different utilities, the water, the sewer, two different enterprise funds, but people get the bill. And so it's the idea is to try to, you know, keep the bill stable so that one side, you know, you don't keep it at 30% on the water side and having and keep the, you know, and have the sewer rates going up as well as the water rates. The idea is to stay within that sweet spot, so to speak, of 20 to 30%.
That was extremely helpful. Thank you.
Okay. So moving on to the sewer fund. We'll just look at the cash requirements on the sewer fund. Is $12,238,068. Again, just converting that modified to a cash requirements. The pie chart here shows that in the sewer fund that the personnel costs are about 19% and 36% or 37% in debt service and capital outlay about 7%. So the pie chart is a little bit changed here for the sewer as opposed to the water. They're operating at 36%. And that's just focusing on fiscal year 14. So that pie, pieces of the pie would change in the later out years. This is just a further breakdown. For stock materials, professional services, so this is your other operating, repairs and maintenance, utilities and chemicals. And again, a similar table that we used in the water, just breaking out the expenses in the other operating by dollars. The key operational budget changes here is what we did when we were reviewing the personnel summary chart. We reallocated some of the costs from the water to the sewer, which is reflects more of what's actually being charged to the water. So there is an increase in the personnel costs, also utilities and chemicals, and again on the health insurance and retirement. And that's what's affecting the sewer budget for FY14. Sewer capital outlay. Again, this is your pay-as-you-go projects identified in the capital improvement plans of $880,000. And then other CIP projects, which would utilize some bond issues of $6 million. And this is the opposite of the water fund. As we talked about the stabilization approach, you can see in FY14 here, where we want to utilize the rate here. There's a little gap between the top of the bar chart to approaching the stabilization. So this is your 12% differential. And what we're proposing for FY14 is a 12% increase in the rate. Now, this is actually raising more revenues than the cash is required for the operations in 14. But what it does is smooths out the rate increase over time. If you look in FY16 and FY17, that orange bar, you're going to be having more expenses than what you actually need to raise rate. We're going to be utilizing that unrestricted net assets in the future years.
Jack?
Just a real quick question on this chart. So if you take fiscal year 14, you would say that the unrestricted net assets are about $8 or $9 million, 72% of 12.
That's correct.
Is that correct?
Correct.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you,
Bob.
Judy, could you just explain that again? You said that over the FY16, 17, expenses increased because of the new facility.
Yes. Yeah, so, two main drivers here is going to be the debt service and then operations. So if you look at the colors, the purple represents the debt service. So you can see in FY17 that bar is much larger. So that's when the debt service will be.
So when you look at the orange bar,
right,
and you see anything above the orange bar, the purple, we're going to pay for that through use of the unrestricted net assets to keep the rate down. So anything above the orange and purple is actually how we're going to pay for it through use of net assets.
Okay. Chris?
How did we get so many assets in sewer? Because, you know, I think some of us had hoped that we would start accruing those earlier, and the council had elected not to do that. But, I mean, how do we get such a good base in...
Year's operation.
It's the 50% increase in 12.
We basically have been...
Let's do it again, is what I'm thinking.
No, what we've been doing, I mean, the council didn't put a policy in place. We understood that there were some issues that we needed to address. So we were being very conservative by utilizing our net assets. We this has been a very challenging time to put a budget together with the sewer department because of a lot of the uncertainties that were coming down the road. And so what we've done is made sure that we had enough cash on hand to deal with a lot of the issues, even though the city council didn't say, to be quite frank, we probably should have done this 3 years ago, this type of policy. And one of the concerns we heard from people in the community that what's going to happen when debt service hits on the wastewater. And we understood that, and we started to be very conservative in how we were approaching our budget. Because we also had some issues as relates to, we were also going through a conservation time. And so if you recall, a few years ago, we started doing this heavy conservation program. And when you start, and by doing that, we were having less water being used. And we were concerned that obviously less water being used is less revenue that would come in on the sewer side. So we wanted to be very conservative because we did not want to see ourselves get into the position of being close to a negative in our net assets, because quite frankly that was kind of the quandary we're in with the conservation. I don't know if you recall, a few years ago we put a big conservation effort in, and it did reduce some of the we did reduce some of the flow. And I guess that was one of the things we've been conservative over time. So,
Tony?
I don't know if there's Dan.
Did you have a
question to answer?
Brad?
Where
can you grab a mic?
Where do the funds, the cash funds and unrestricted debt assets sit, and do they earn interest?
Yes, they do. We invest all our money. We invest all our money.
Restricted by statute? Okay, so it's low.
It's all 100% collateralized instruments. Treasury,
The slide before where it has $6 million for bond funded CIP projects, that has nothing to do with the new wastewater treatment plant, correct? That's just maintenance of the present.
Part of it does.
Oh.
Yeah, it's the $2.5 million is for the design, starting the design effort.
The key here is that because of the size of this capital project that we're going to be having hit our ratepayers, we're trying to keep it so that we have a smooth glide path in, so not any one year you have a huge spike. So that's really the key that we want to have as a takeaway here.
Jack?
I just did a quick calculation on the next couple of years, and it looks like fiscal year 15 and 16 both have approximately $10 million in that fund.
Could you move back to the other chart, please?
In the unrestricted net assets of about $10 million. Actually, it turns out both calculations end up about the same. But in 14 is $6 million, so you have an increase of $4 million in 1 year, and I'm curious where that money actually comes from.
David, do you want to just speak to
accumulated
your
revenues?
Yeah, the 14 number there, when it's 72%, that would be the unrestricted net assets at the end of the year. So you're contributing $1.8 million to unrestricted net assets in fiscal year 14. And then in the subsequent year, you're contributing the delta to get you up to the 78%. So there'd be contributions that would occur to net assets in both 14 and 15 that would arrive at that 78% at the end of fiscal year 15. And then each of these in subsequent years, the 61% is at the end of fiscal year 16, where you've started to eat into those net assets to allow for the smoothing.
Okay. Correct me if I'm wrong. Maybe I'm not understanding this chart after all, but 72% times 12 million is somewhere in the vicinity of 8 million. But 78% of almost 14 million and 61% of over 16 million turn out to be approximately the same, around 10. My question is, where does the bump of money actually come from? We're accumulating during that period of time?
Correct. You are.
Chris?
And is the industry standard for the percentage that you should maintain is about the same for sewer as it is for water?
Correct.
Is that your goal?
Yep.
And what's going to happen is, going past 18 into 19, 20, 21, you're going to start seeing that service start to slide down again. So that way, we'll have, and I think that was the year. Was it 21 was the year that it started sliding down, 18?
The percent increases dropped significantly.
I'm talking about the debt service.
The debt service?
Debt service. After, I think there was it started moving down around 20, 21.
Yeah, in 20 it drops by about 500,000.
Yeah,
and then
so
subsequently.
See, what's happening is you're now having that chunk coming through. You know, it's not all going to hit in 18 because we've got it. You know, we're hiring the professional engineer. We're doing the design. We're starting to do a lot of the work over that time. So we're going to have some debt service payments. As you get out to 20, well, the idea is when you kind of get over that hump, that peak, it's going to start moving down. And that way you can kind of get into that, as Jack was saying, you're kind of going to get into that sweet spot with water and sewer, you know? And I can't say that it's going to go up by inflation, but, you know.
Okay.
Later.
Yeah. Did you get all your questions answered? All right. Are we ready for the next slide?
So here's the sewer revenues. And again, if you look at the very bottom here, the rate stabilization reserve, this is the amount that we're talking about that we need to raise in order to include into the net assets to use into the future years. So it's the $1.8 million. This is above and beyond the cash requirements that we talked about earlier. So the user rate being $11 million plus the $1.8 million would be raising a cash amount of $13 million. Again, reserving this amount for the future rates. And again, this is also a tool. We have to look at this. I mean, it's very difficult to estimate the consumption. Like we said, we've had some years in FY12, FY13, where anything like just the environment, you know, if there's a lot of rain, your consumption is going to be different. If we lose a big customer, the consumption is going to be different. So it's more difficult to estimate the consumptions, but we utilize the trends. We've seen that trend going down in the last few years. So, and then there's other revenues, state aid grant. We've lost significant amount of state aid grant in the last few years that the city manager had mentioned earlier in the opening statement. So. Proposed sewer rate being at 12%. Again, we're using the two-tier rate, the 10 units or less per month for the first tier, and then the second tier over 10 units a month. We are showing an increase in the first year of $1.14. As you can see, the increase to the capital-related expenses is increasing because we are adding more capital projects that are required by the regulatory requirements. The second tier is for over 10 units. The capital-related expenses, $5.66, over 10 units, $6.09, or a total of $11.75. So what does this mean to the average residential single-family home? Now, for the city of Portsmouth, our single-family consumption is about the average of 5 units per month. And this makes up about 66% of the average single residential uses 5 or less units per month. This impact would be a change of $5.70 a month. That's the last.
Tony.
So the average house uses 125 gallons a day of water. That's actually lower than I thought.
For Portsmouth, it's about 5.
One of the things that we've really done as part of this rate study is drill deep in terms of the data. And when you look at our past data was really aggregated into large groups, and so we weren't able to differentiate residential usage. And by doing this analysis, we got some great information, and we showed that the average household is five units, which is low.
It would be helpful. This is kind of a sidebar. I wonder, in terms of conservation efforts, to on your bill, to let the residential rate the payer understand where they are in terms of the average. Mm. So if someone, got a bill and said, the average Portsmouth resident's using 125 gallons a day, and your bill is 150, it might cause I wonder if I should change my toilets. I wonder if I think toilets are the largest driver in terms of the water usage. Is that correct, Peter?
It might toilets are a very large
probe people to look at their water usage, and if they understood that they're way above the average, or be proud of if they're way below. Just a thought.
Yes, good point.
Any other questions, Nancy?
But I think, Peter, I remember you saying in a meeting once that you think that people in Portsmouth are particularly concerned about conserving.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah, not flushing as much, and I remember you saying.
And again,
that,
we had a major conservation effort a few years ago.
Any other questions? So I think what we need to be thinking about is when we come time to vote on this, we're going to vote on this rate increase as part of the budget.
Yes, there'll be a resolution. As you recall, there are multiple resolutions that you'll have in front of you. The next meeting we'll have is April 29th, which will encompass discussions relative to the capital, because I know that's still outstanding, and anything else that the City Council wants to talk about for the 29th. And then on May 6th, it's our hope that we'll be bringing to you the various resolutions. There's for the general fund, for the water and sewer fund, for all the other funds, all federal funds. We have multiple resolutions. And what we'll do for you is for the April 29th meeting, we will bring copies of those resolutions. They may not, we'll have numbers in them, or we may leave them blank depending on what the council wants to do. But I think in advance of that, we'll have those resolutions so you'll know what you'll get on May 6th. So we'll put those resolutions. We've done that in the past. I think it might be helpful for you to see the resolutions that you're going to have to act on at the May 6th meeting. So like I said, there's one for general fund, there's one for water, there's one for sewer, there's one for our policy on investments, et cetera.
Bob?
Thank you. This has been very helpful, thanks. But I want to go back to the conservation measures for a second, because I know we're always trying to save water and changing toilets and using a rain barrel and those kinds of things. Is there any kind of a, and I'm not looking to give anybody anything else to do, is there any kind of a fact sheet that could go out with water bills that talks about some of the ways people could save money? Again, as a reminder, maybe it already exists. I don't know that.
We have done that in the past, but the key one that really for people is people sometimes have a drippy faucet or a running toilet that can be very, very expensive for them. So that's a key item to get fixed. You don't realize it, you know, that, but it does. If you have that loss constantly, it can be substantial.
And so just things like that, I mean, I think would be helpful. I mean, there, a lot of them are common sense things, obviously. But again, if people realize how much money they're spending on units of water, right, and if they can conserve water, that helps everybody. It's a win-win situation. So I just,
Chris,
I think it's this conversation is very helpful, and this is an area where I have a real hard time wrapping my head around, like the 125 gallons, or to begin making it real for people. I think it would be very interesting, particularly to see some commercial breakouts, because, you know, one of the big concerns that we all had about the wastewater treatment plant was the effect on various kinds of businesses and commercial users. So without, you know, divulging like private information or something, but just like you did, you know, 66% of our residents is in this group.
We have that.
Yeah, exactly. That would be very helpful just to get a handle on that, because as people start to either panic about it or complain about it or wonder what's happening, so that we have a bigger picture of, you know, how does it play out across,
right.
Like, what does a restaurant use? I would have no idea, you know, or you know, what do 66% of the commercial entities use?
We've already done some of this work. We can take and do a typical restaurant, typical manufacturing, typical office. And one thing you're going to find, because we are heavily restaurant orientated, you're going to find that there'll be those that are going to go towards conservation methods, because I did a tour of one of the local restaurants, and they use a lot of recycling of water for certain things that so that they're not, there's not constant water going down the drain. It's very interesting, some of the technologies that they're starting to look at. So as costs increase for them, it's going to become, their payback on these is going to come a lot quicker. And so they'll be looking at those as well.
How do we compare to other communities? Has that ever been
Peter,
done?
In terms of how we compare to other communities, I think we are pretty, I think we're pretty low on the water side, and then the sewer side, I think we're about.
Are you talking about rates or talking about
rates,
consumption?
Rates.
Both, I guess.
Both.
On the sewer side, we're on the higher side. I think we're probably in the region, we're probably tied with Newington has a high rate. I think they're a little bit higher, but they charge only the industrial. They don't charge their, they don't have really any residential on that. On the water side, we're on the lower side. Exeter and a number of other communities are higher than us. So, you know, our water rate used to be, you know, some of the lowest, but when we built our new treatment plant, it brought us up into the middle of the pack. But we're doing very well, as John had said, in terms of the water side. We're projecting, you know, inflation rate increases into the future on that one. And as he indicated, on the sewer side, after this initial bump, we're going to be down in the 3 to 2% range inflation as well within 7 years.
And the other thing you got to remember, the other communities have to build plants that they never had certain expenses that they're going to have. So when you're going to be looking at the region, obviously, I think we're all going to be about in the same type of area.
Yeah. Nancy.
Have we seen much savings with the new water plant in Madbury?
It's hard to quantify that saving. When you say savings, we've increased the treatment level, and there's a lot. So we're treating the water to a higher quality or higher standards. So it's, you know, on one hand, had we not improved our treatment efficiency, our costs would have been higher. So, you know, one of the things we're doing right now is we're working with a local firm to kind of tease out the energy efficiencies and to better nail down the costs. As Judy had said, our sludge costs are higher now because we're removing more from the water, and our chemical costs are tracking higher. Part of that's due to inflation, costs associated with chemicals and energy. But, you know, at this point, we don't have those exact numbers.
And the other thing is, at some point, we weren't going to be able to meet the federal standards with the old plant.
That's exactly right.
There's nothing like not meeting the federal standards and needing 3 years to build a plant. So it, it was necessary.
Need to do.
And just in terms of usage, you are low. What we typically see on the East Coast is about 6.5 units. Would be more standard for average residential. So you are on the lower end for sure with five.
Well, I can tell you I'm not contributing to the lower end. I did do the research that some of you were talking about with my own house. I have the very old style toilets, and they're 6 gallons of flush.
And three girls.
And three girls.
That's what does
and
it.
I have figured out about half of my bill is from the toilet, which is amazing because we're treating this beautiful, pristine, drinkable water. It just goes in the toilet. And the payback that the city manager was talking about in terms of replacement of, you know, how you use, as these bills get increased, that formula changes, and now suddenly these low-flow toilets become very attractive. Any other comments? And so I guess the kind of around the table here, you're not voting tonight, but the consensus is this is a good plan in terms of everyone is
yes.
pretty comfortable. Any reservations from anybody that they're concerned about? Great. All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.